Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back. It's Global Running Day and our video seminar series continues. We've got Coach Greg McMillan with us right now. Greg, how are you doing today? Happy Global Running Day.
Same to you. Thanks for having me.
Pleasure as always. Did you get your run in yet today?
Of course. First thing every day. It's get that out of the way. Makes me feel better and usually makes the rest of the day go better.
Where'd you run and how long?
I did 4 miles today. I'd done a leg speed workout last night, so I was a little nervous about how I'd feel. I actually felt better than I thought I would. So I did 4 miles on the Wildcat Canyon Trail here, which was lovely.
Fantastic. Well, Greg, today we're going to talk about how to run mistake-free. And you're going to share a lot of great advice when it comes to training, nutrition, some of the mental tips for beginner runners. Because really, it's all about not making those mistakes, especially when you're new to the sport, right?
Yeah, it's a big problem in the sport, right, is that people start and they fall in love with it and they get excited, but then sort of fall into the usual traps that a lot of us did that make the mistakes that lead to injury and loss of motivation and interruptions in training. And just when you kind of fall in love with the sport and are really excited, often that's when these sort of interruptions happen. And we really try to work to help runners avoid those so they can have a smooth time as they grow in the sport.
And Greg, as a coach, you know, you've worked on the elite side, but nowadays you're really working with a lot of runners and new runners to the sport. Can you share just your experience when it comes to working with people who are moving up in distance for the first time or even just starting to run for the first time?
Yeah, it's been really fun. When I was in graduate school and then one of my first jobs after that was working in a cardiac rehab unit. So we had people that actually had had some sort of cardiac event and we were moving them toward being more active. And that was sort of like something I'd never experienced before. People that we could have them walk for 30 seconds or a minute and build them up over time. And what I learned from that was this process that the body goes through in developing its fitness. And if you're patient and gradual yet progressive, you can really build people over time. So I was able to work with those sort of cardiac patients, get them moving again, and then worked with a lot of charity marathon groups, you know, where you sign up and you raise money and then you run an event. And that's where we saw a lot of people who were often they hadn't run or they hadn't run recently and they were getting into the sport, often kind of coming off the couch or out from behind the computer, wanting to have this goal of finishing the marathon, but maybe being out of shape, maybe a little overweight. And it was a big challenge as a coach to learn how to take people from essentially starting over or starting from zero and build them toward this goal and have them stay healthy and stay motivated and achieve some of their weight loss goals and their fitness goals, as well as the race goal at the end. So I've really enjoyed that process because, number one, the people see gigantic improvements because there's lots of room for improvement because they're new to the sport. And number two is it's a wonderful opportunity to try to help them avoid the mistakes that I personally made. And I think a lot of us who've been running for a long time have made and see, okay, what do you need to do with different people coming from different backgrounds to help them move through the sport, become fitter, leaner, ready for whatever their goals are, but doing it in a way that kind of avoids those interruptions that many face.
I don't know how exactly if there's a way to quantify this, but do in your sense, you know, the new runners entering the sport today with running and the explosion of popularity, you know, over the last decade or so, or perhaps whatever that time period is, do new runners today perhaps have less experience coming into the sport in your eyes as a coach as maybe they did a decade plus ago? Is there essentially more that needs to be taught when people enter in the sport now?
I think so. I think with the second running boom, you know, sort of the charity marathon movement where we had this really large growth, obviously had a lot of people that were ancillary to the sport coming into it. They really had never had any exposure to it or very little possibly a long time ago. And they were coming into the sport with a different kind of mindset than, say, the first running boom was a lot of more competitive, like I want to be Frank Shorter and, you know, really challenge these time goals and Now we have kind of a blend of some people that are time goal focused and then a lot that are a little bit more, you know, focused on the experience of doing it. And so that brought, I think, another group of people into the sport, and that provided an opportunity to say, okay, let's reset. And maybe we need to rethink about how we train beginning runners, because they're not athletes who ran in high school or college and then are kind of continuing on or returning after a few years. Maybe they have no experience in the past and now they're getting into the sport. And how can we make it something that it's not just a bucket list where they check off, I did the marathon and leave the sport? How can they fall in love with it, stay motivated, make connections with other runners, and kind of become a runner and stay in the sport for a lifetime?
It's almost like that second running boom, in a way, makes you stay sharp as a coach, right? Keeping focus on all these fundamentals, because it's what a lot of the athletes that you're coaching really need. Let's start, Greg, as we dive into this topic, on the training side of things. So let's talk through some basic training tips that fit into this theme of how to run mistake free. And starting out, you know, I mean, I'm sure for a lot of people when they get started running, it's kind of tempting to perhaps go to the running store, grab a pair of running shoes, and then just start to go out there and try to run. What would your recommended path be for somebody who's had very little experience to get started running? And where does working with a coach fit in?
Well, I definitely like the idea of going to your local specialty running store, getting fit for shoes. That's our only equipment really that is required, is a good pair of shoes. So that's a good place to start. And then for new runners, I'd love for them to get connected with a community running program. I think that having somebody there with you, having training partners that can help guide you, and then usually there's a coach in that system, can really help you through that initial process of going from zero to becoming a runner. There has to be that community part, because you need the accountability. There's a lot to learn. There's a lot of things that are maybe specific to you that somebody else has gone through in the past, and they can share that. And then having a coach will help you sort of control your development. And that's the thing that's kind of weird about running, if you will, is that instead of just getting as fit as fast as you possibly can, in running you actually have to stall your fitness development slightly, because the musculoskeletal system does not advance its durability as fast as, say, the heart and lungs. The heart and lungs adapt very, very quickly to aerobic sort of running type exercise. But the musculoskeletal system takes a little bit longer. So good coaches are always holding back new runners. They're always saying, no, we can't do too much too soon, too frequently. It's called the rule of twos. Beware the rule of twos is what I write about in my book. And it's about, hey, don't get over anxious, because it's gonna feel good. You're gonna feel better mentally when you run. It's not gonna be as you're not gonna suffer as much, and your breathing's gonna be under control. So you're gonna wanna do more and faster. But that musculoskeletal system does not adapt quite as fast. So you have to control yourself and hold back a little bit. And that's really tough for new runners, because you fall in love with the sport. You're with these people that you enjoy sharing this activity with, and you want more and more and more of it. And that's where usually we see people within 4 to 12 weeks of beginning a running program, they end up with an injury, their first running injury. And we prefer them never to have a running injury. So that's why good coaching helps hold people back a little bit, so that all aspects of their fitness, from their cardiovascular fitness, and then most importantly, from the musculoskeletal fitness, that can adapt in a way that the body can handle. It'll grow stronger. You just got to do it in sort of a gradual, progressive way.
For somebody that is a new runner, you know, with the temptation to perhaps, whether it's socially or bucket list kind of thing, like jump directly into a marathon or a half marathon, how do you, you know, navigate and negotiate that? I mean, I'm sure with everybody it's a little bit different, but is there a general approach in terms of building to that, say, half marathon and up type of distance?
Well, I take a little bit different approach than a lot of new runner programs that are going straight into the marathon. With new runners, I want to build them into a complete runner first. And so I want them to learn how the sport works, because essentially there's kind of four different effort levels or speeds in running. There's easy, there's sort of medium, there's hard, and there's very hard. And if you just train for distance with only the focus toward the marathon goal, then you only kind of do the easy and sometimes the medium. But I think it's really beneficial for people that are new to the sport to have a variety of different workouts. They should learn, okay, what's good running technique uphill? What's good running technique downhill? What does it feel like when I'm running very quickly? What about medium? What about heavy breathing versus controlling my breath? I think that's a really good system to have in place overall. Running form, helping them have better running form, those kinds of things. You're almost teaching the basics, the techniques of running, the exposure to these different effort levels. And while I was doing that, I would sprinkle in the training that was necessary to help them accomplish their goal of the marathon. But my end result was that I wanted them to be a really well-rounded runner. I want them to be able to have exposure to all sorts of different types of running. And that way, when they finished the marathon, they could jump in a 5K or a 10K or anything else. They could go to a local training group that maybe had a weekly workout, and they wouldn't feel intimidated that, oh, I'm going to this track workout. I don't know what a track workout, I don't know how to do this. They'd have a better comfort level with that. So my approach was a little bit different in that I really wanted them to have a lot of exposure to different types of workouts. Even if that was not specific to their marathon goal, I knew it was better for them to be a runner. And then I knew I could get enough marathon specific workouts in to get them to the goal time. Sometimes, you know, you have to kind of educate the runner what you're doing, but in the end, it provided a lot of variety. They weren't just always, oh, I've got to try to run farther than I did last week. They kind of removed that somewhat and made it a little bit more fun, which maintained their motivation, particularly when they were in kind of those longer 16, 20 week training programs for a marathon. It can become arduous. So that was my approach, was a slightly different than just goal focused of the marathon, and more, I want to teach you how to be a runner, and we'll do the marathon as well, but I bet you're going to fall in love with the sport, and you're going to say you're never going to do another marathon, and then you're going to sign up for your next one. So we need to make sure we teach you how to be a runner.
And I think it makes a lot of sense if you were to analogize it to another sport. You wouldn't, you know, jump into a basketball game without learning how to dribble or learning how to shoot, you know. So yeah, I think the way you described it is really very logical if you were to compare it to any other sport or activity you might try to do.
You're right. Most other sports do a lot of non-sporting activities to get ready for their sport, right? So there's golfers are spending a ton of time working on the range and technique before they go and actually do the sport, you know, out on the course. And in running, particularly with new runners, I think there's a lot of that kind of component that should be done, because then it gives the athlete a better skill set, but then also exposure, just knowledge, just a comfort level with different things, which I think will help them as they grow in the sport.
So Greg, as we're talking about different types of workouts for beginner runners, you sort of have two specific workouts, right, that are your favorites for new runners and for beginner runners. So can you share those with us?
Yeah, one of the things I like to do with new runners, because a lot of times with new runners, the kind of standard MO is just run longer than you did before and have some progression of distance only. And I think throwing in some surges or stride workouts or something where you're varying the pace during the run, again, so the runner gets exposure to this is what easy running feels like. This is medium. This is hard. This is very hard. And I'm going to sprinkle those in. So I like kind of these surges where you're not just running continuously, say for 30 minutes or 45 minutes, but in the middle of that, maybe you're speeding up for 15 or 20 seconds and slowing down, speeding up again, kind of this fartlek or speed play idea. I think, again, that gives that athlete the opportunity to experience different effort levels. It also burns a lot more calories that way. It mixes up the run too, so they're not sort of arduous, oh, I've got to get to this time. They have something else to think about. I really like that for new runners. I feel like that's very helpful in teaching best running technique. They don't become kind of a slow runner only. They have exposure to different speeds. The other one that I like, and this fits well with new runners, because a lot of times with a new runner, they run too fast early in their run, and then they kind of suffer the last half and they slow down, and it's not a very pleasant experience. So I have them do progression runs where the purpose is to start slow, but then the last maybe 5 or 10 minutes is run at a faster pace, maybe a medium pace or medium hard pace. That helps them control starting out because they're a little bit afraid of what's coming, and teaches them the way that more experienced runners run, which is starting slower and finishing faster. That's kind of a hallmark of more experienced runners, whereas less experienced runners, they're sort of the opposite. They're often the start fast, finish slow type. So I like those two, again, because it mixes it up mentally. I think it builds a different skill set and exposure for the athlete. It burns more calories. It gives them kind of a better workout. But again, it's not overly strenuous. It's not like a really hard workout. So they're able to recover and their body can adapt to that. Kind of adds some fun. I tell you, when I do this, particularly in the beginning of these plans with athletes, their fitness develops and they suddenly start to feel just different. They feel more athletic. And that is a great situation for the athlete where they're excited and motivated to keep this thing going. And so I really like those two. Is simple. It doesn't require a track or any, it's just mostly done by effort, but again, really benefits their fitness a lot.
It's great stuff. So I think a good perspective on kind of your overall training philosophy in terms of building the complete runner, and then a couple of specific tips that are workout ideas that people can try as they progress in their running. Now let's move on, Greg, to nutrition. It's so tied in oftentimes with the goals of the beginner runner, especially somebody who might be using running as a way to reach a fitness or weight loss goal. And, you know, kind of this whole, some of these things around reward eating and things, it's something we see a lot in running. From your perspective, what are sort of the fundamental challenges that a lot of new runners face when it comes to just knowing how to go about fueling their activity?
Well, it's a big challenge a lot of times because people often don't understand how easy it is to eat a bunch of calories and how hard it is to burn those calories. So, you know, you burn approximately 100 calories per mile, but a donut you could eat in just a minute or two, but you certainly can't cover a mile in a minute or two. So you have to be careful with thinking, oh, I'm burning a ton of calories so I can really consume a lot. In fact, with my new runners, most of the time, and particularly those that have weight loss goals, I'm saying we need to really focus on your nutrition for the first 6 to 8 weeks of this program, because we want to get that weight down, because we're going to be doing more running later and we want that weight off. Because remember, I mentioned injuries, the musculoskeletal system, that's the thing that gets injured. So when you're landing with 2.5 to 3 times your body weight, you can see how removing 10 pounds, 20 pounds, 30 pounds from that makes a big difference over time. So a lot of the focus is let's clean up the diet, all the easy stuff. You can immediately kind of get rid of that. And then you need to be smart 90% of the time, you know, do the things you should do, make sure you're making good decisions. And then that 10% of the time you can sort of, you know, have the things that you really like, because part of food is enjoyment as well. So you don't want to not eat something that you really like eating. You just want to be smart. Now, one of the things that we see particularly in the charity marathon groups, is that people will go and do a long run and they'll do, say, a 10-mile long run, and then they'll go to the buffet and they will clean it out, saying, oh, well, I just burned all these calories. I'm going to eat. I can eat whatever I want. But again, if they ran 10 miles, that's probably around 1,000 calories. But if you look at any of the calorie numbers on a buffet, you can blow through that really quickly. So sometimes people will finish a marathon training plan and not have lost weight and sometimes gained weight. And that's a very frustrating situation. But a lot of times it is from this reward eating or this sort of like, hey, I did this, now I can really splurge. And I'm not against that idea of, like, you know, rewarding yourself. You just need to be smart about it and not really get too carried away. Make sure you're kind of monitoring your hunger levels and eating in a way that controls your hunger levels so that you can fuel your running, but also achieve your weight loss goals.
And, you know, Greg, like just culturally, if we think about, you know, even the setup of a lot of these races, traditionally it's been sort of very carbohydrate and sugar dominant, right? It's the pasta dinners, it's bagels post-run, it's bananas pre-run, it's sports drinks with sugar and gels with sugar. And certainly those types of things, you know, have their place when it comes to performance, when you're going longer. But for the runner who's just getting started, you know, this idea of really emphasizing or overemphasizing carbohydrates or needing sports nutrition products, just, you know, can you speak to that a little bit? Like, should that really be the focus?
No, all the fuel, all the that's going to be burned during the run, the athlete already has on board. In fact, they usually have a surplus. That's why they're overweight and they want to lose. So there is absolutely no reason that they would need to feel like they need to really go all in on sort of this, the fueling idea that we see from the carbo loading and some of that. That's not necessary for this type of runner because they already have all that fuel on board. Now, it doesn't mean that they don't need to eat or anything like that. It's just that if you're not burning a lot of calories, if you're not going long, if you're not exercising really intensely, you've got enough on board and your regular diet can probably provide all that you need. So you certainly would want to be very careful if you're trying to restrict calories that you didn't get carried away with some of those things that maybe you see the really fast runners that are doing really long runs and intense runs. They need that because they've kind of burned that. You actually want to burn that because that's part of your weight loss goal.
And, you know, when you were talking about fueling up about the run, right, that's sort of exactly it. It's not so much thinking about fuel for the run. It's just eating in a way where you're controlling your blood sugar, controlling your energy, so you don't have these dips going into the run. So, you know, for a lot of new runners, in terms of recommending how they eat, is it a lot of it more around like meal timing and just making sure you're timing meals around workouts, sort of your regular meal versus thinking about what do I need to eat right before I start this activity?
Yeah, a lot of time it is just number one, cleaning up your diet. Number two, the timing of when you are eating. And then this is another thing that we talk a lot about with beginning runners is become attentive to how you feel after what you eat. Because most of us in our daily lives, we don't think about that too much. But when you become more of an athlete and you get kind of tuned into your body, it can make a big difference what you had for breakfast, how you might feel for your lunch run or even that afternoon. So you begin to learn like these are the things I can eat that satiate me for a long time so I don't have anything on my stomach and I can go do my activity versus something that I eat that I'm going to be hungry again in 2 hours, but I'm going to go for a lunch run and then I'm going to be starving. So what am I supposed to do? So you start to really kind of get tuned in to what you eat and how it makes you feel. And most people then, their diet begins to narrow around their running in that they have a better idea of what to eat and how it will make them feel. And luckily, most of that makes you feel better for your running is the less processed, less sugary. It is the better for you diet typically is the one that works best within this sort of timing of going for your runs. Doesn't mean you won't need occasionally to have like a UCAN shake, right? Like, oh man, I'm just starving. I've got to go do this run in an hour. I really need something. What should I choose? Doesn't mean you won't run into those situations, but it just means that you're more attentive to what you eat and the connection with that to how you run. And that a lot of people don't think about. They only think about fueling for the run or fueling after the run or not fueling because they're trying to lose weight. And they don't often make the connection with how what you eat can impact how you feel. And we talk about this with Generation UCAN a lot, right? Steady blood sugar. The body's happy with steady blood sugar. It is not happy with spikes and crashes, which is why we get grumpy and frustrated easily when we're hungry. So you start to get more in tune with that idea of what's going to keep me sort of everything is in a happy place. And then usually your runs are always better. You don't have GI problems, but you also feel good for your runs. That makes them more positive and, you know, more stacking more of those positive workouts together that's how you build this momentum that we're looking for.
I think what you said too about just paying attention to how what you eat makes you feel is so true, and it's probably so overlooked because, you know, when you're not doing that, then it kind of just becomes a calorie equation, right? It's like, oh, mm-hmm. I just need calories. It's 100 calories from this. It's 100 calories from that. But we all know that, you know, different nutrients, different types of carbohydrates, different fuel sources react differently. So Greg, just real quick, you know, in talking about UCAN and how it might benefit the beginner runner, when it ties back to blood sugar management, something like the UCAN shake or the UCAN bar, it's giving you carbohydrates, but it's giving it to you without all the sugar. So it's a much more slow and steady approach, making your calories count last for longer instead of having to keep fueling frequently with something that might be sugary. And then, you know, for the new runner, you were talking about, you know, not necessarily needing lots of calories to support the workout, at least initially, you know, when the distances are shorter. But for people looking for hydration, something like the UCAN Hydrate, it's giving them electrolytes without sugar. So I think kind of putting a bow on everything you're saying from a dietary standpoint, right? When you clean up the diet and do it without sugar, it's going to make what you eat last you longer. And we kind of look at it the same from the fueling approach when it comes to sports nutrition for the beginner runner. When you can fuel with something like UCAN without all the sugar, it's that more energy sustaining approach that's going to support your fitness goals.
Totally. And one of the most successful things I've been doing with overweight beginning runners is saying, hey, go with the UCAN recovery shake, the one with protein, and that can be a great meal replacement for you because you can take it in, you get fewer calories, but it satiates you for longer. So for those athletes who are looking for a way to reduce their caloric intake, but not be hungry, because that's the hardest thing, right? If you're used to a certain diet, you know, we all know, well, just eat 500 calories less a day and you'll lose all this weight. And it's like, yeah, but that's a big change for the body. And how are you not going to be really grumpy to live with? So you look for these strategies where you can take something like the Generation UCAN and that will satiate you for longer with a lower caloric intake. That's been very successful, at least for me, in the really early parts of training programs to help people drop that weight early, get them lighter as they're getting stronger and as they're learning how to run. So then when we get to the really more intense training, they're kind of a lean, mean running machine and they're ready to go out there and really see what they can do.
It's a great perspective. You know, when we think about fueling, oftentimes we think of it as what do I eat before an activity, but you're talking about just the whole approaching nutrition and fueling, even what you do post-run can set up what you do, you know, from a food intake standpoint after that. So yeah, that's a great perspective, Greg. Let's wrap this up with just covering some mental tips for a few minutes. So I was just before this session doing one of these with Tyler Pinnell and Nicole DiMercurio, two elite runners that finished top 10 at the Crazy Boston Marathon this year. And both of them were talking, you know, about having to dig deep in those conditions. And it kind of struck me that it's something that you hear referenced so often in running, you know, digging deep, fighting through it, but it also is probably a learned skill, right? You probably don't go from never having run to just suddenly knowing how to dig deep. So is that teachable? And do you have any tricks to teach new runners how to push through and not give up?
Well, that's one of the reasons I like this variety approach to workouts for new runners, is that I think they need to start out with small exposures to suffering, where you feel tired and the voice in your brain is saying, slow down, or your breathing's really heavy and your brain's kind of like, what is going on? I don't like this. You need small doses of it in the beginning, and then that begins to get greater and greater and greater. And that's what these athletes are talking about, is that they've had so much exposure to these sort of opportunities to suffer and to have to overcome essentially their own brain saying, stop doing this, slow down. And if you just gave that same feeling to a new runner, they would stop because they have no exposure to it. But over time, they can learn to push themselves a little bit more. Their brain kind of gets comfortable. We know from neuroscience now that the brain can easily learn, oh, that feeling, that heavy breathing, that discomfort, that's okay. It's not a threat. You can keep going. So that's kind of the mental trick that we talk about as well, is like, hey, it's okay to suffer a little bit. Just do it in small doses in the beginning, and then slowly you can do a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more. And you'll have some days when you're better at kind of fighting the suffering than others. But on the whole, you definitely can develop the ability to kind of push even though you're tired. Though I do think having a variety of exposure, so it's not just long and slow duration exposure to kind of that type of suffering. I think there should be heavy breathing. I think there should be fast leg turnover. I think there should be all those different types of ways that runners kind of put themselves in a situation where they suffer. That helps build that ability to kind of dig deep. And it takes a little bit of time, and you need to do it in small doses, but you'd be amazed. I mean, we see it all the time at finish lines. It's people that they had no idea they would possibly be able to do what they just did. If you'd ask them 6 months ago, could they do this? They said impossible. And if you'd had them try to do it then, they wouldn't have been able to do it. But over time, they built this person, this mind and body that was able to go out there and do something that ultimately is pretty extraordinary.
And, you know, I think that's a great place to wrap it up, because really that being able to see that and see those stories time and time again, I mean, that's what keeps this fun and exciting. There's always someone out there who can experience that joy and that thrill for the first time.
Yeah.
Well, thanks so much, Greg. This was fantastic. For folks that want to get some more info that you have to put out there, you have tons of content on your website, a lot of opportunities for people to learn more from you. What's the best way?
Yeah, go to McMillanRunning.com. We've got all the information there. There's a ton of resources that are available for athletes. And then there are training plans. There's Rebuild Fitness plans, which are great for this new runner, is kind of getting started, building that fitness up. And then, of course, coaching opportunities for people that want a little bit more input on their training. We're happy to help in any way we possibly can.
Tons of info there, tons of great content for new runners and for all runners. So I encourage you to check it out. Greg, thanks so much. Appreciate the time, and we'll talk to you soon.
You bet. Take care.
Take care.